room here at the S.J. Quinney College of Law. Anyone graduate from law school here? Yes? At least, oh, Mike, I should know, it's gonna be Mike Maurer. Clapping his hands over here. Well, of course, when I went to law school here, we didn't have this beautiful building, but this is just such a great place to meet. We're so glad you are here today. Our students just finished the semester. This is the first couple of days back, so they're still acclimating, so we're glad to have you here. And particularly tonight, we're celebrating a pretty major event right now for our governor. How many days has he been in office?
500 days.
Almost. Tomorrow, 500 days in office tomorrow. And this is a time when we're going to reflect. This evening, we're going to have a conversation with our great governor. We're going to talk about what's happened in the 500 days. As you know, when you're in campaign mode, you make certain promises. When you get into office, do I need a microphone?
We're broadcasting.
How's that? I'm not starting over.
No.
Does that sound better?
All right, then. I guess we'll use this from now on. What I was talking about is when you start running for office, there are things that you say you're going to do. And every great elected official takes a time during certain markers doing an administration where they take an accounting. How are we doing on the promises we've made? If we have some kind of plan, how are we doing on that plan? Tonight, we're going to talk about it. We're going to go through each one of these steps that Governor Cox put forward, see how we've done, what's happening right now, and where we are going forward. And I kind of felt like since we're sitting here at the University of Utah, maybe this is a little bit like a report card night. Jen, is that okay? Report card night? Are we gonna let him do his own grading? we're gonna talk about that tonight too. So this is how it's going to work. We're gonna take a few minutes. I'm gonna go through a couple things with the governor, some of the economic plan and other things. And then you're gonna have a chance to ask some questions. Do we have paper already passed out? Jen, I want to talk about how this is going to work. So while we're doing this conversation tonight, think about what you would like to ask the governor. So after we do our part, we're going to turn it over to you, all right? So you'll pass your pieces of paper forward. Jennifer Napier Pierce will collect them, or someone from the team will, and then we'll go through those and answer the questions. Sound good? All right, let's give a hand to Governor Spencer Cox. Governor, welcome. You're gonna have to push mute. I learned the hard way.
It's green now. Is
all
that
right,
better?
Yes.
All right, we got it. Passed the first test.
Okay, good. The questions get harder from there.
Oh, good.
Glad to have you with us today.
Thank you.
Let me just talk really quickly, just get out kind of the elephant here. We're fist bumping, we're a little separated, we're wearing masks.
Yeah, this is all my fault.
Something going on, Gov?
Yeah, so as everyone knows, I tested positive for COVID. First time, it took over 2 years. I don't know how many exposures I've had, but this one finally got me. It's been 7 days now, and according to CDC guidelines, I'm good. Haven't had a fever since Sunday, and symptoms are basically all gone, which is great. And so I need to wear a mask, and I certainly don't want to infect anyone else, least of all you. I know you've got some travel plans coming up, and we don't want you to get stuck somewhere. So
that's true.
Taking all the precautions to be safe.
Yeah, well, so glad you're here with us. As you heard me do in the intro, I want to talk a bit tonight about kind of your plan going forward. And you know, we talk about some things that happened during your campaign, some promises that you made, talk about those promises kept, and maybe some that you're still working on. But maybe I can start this for a second because I have sort of an interesting, unique perspective. I've worked for several governors, and I've asked a version of this question to each one of them when I work for them and otherwise. As you campaign and you work to get this position, which is hard work, what do you think, what's your favorite thing about being governor? When you think about all that's happened over the last 500 days, anything stand out?
So being governor is fascinating, and you know, I too had been around governors. Obviously, I'd been a lieutenant governor, and I've met with dozens of governors, not just here in Utah but across the country, and all of them said something recently. They've all said something. Being governor was much more fun before COVID. That's the one thing they'll tell me. So certainly I've missed out on a few things, but to me, and I don't know how else to explain it. It's just the small things, being around people across the state. It's the things that no one else gets to see. When I get to have a conversation with someone, usually on their best days, but sometimes on their worst days, governors get to see people on those days. You're there because you're you're honoring someone, you know, they're receiving an award, something great is happening, they're opening a new business, or something tragic has happened. Yeah. They've lost a loved one. And so I get to see people on their best days and on their worst days, but on all those days I get to see the best of people. And that's, I think, the thing that I've enjoyed the most as governor. I did get to meet Garth Brooks, which was pretty cool too. So I guess that's another thing. So
That is true. And I always have to say, because we of course had him here at the University of Utah,
yeah,
and he's coming back again.
He is, he promised he would.
He's mentioned you several times, just so you know,
oh,
to our team here. So you liked him.
That's very kind.
He kind of liked you also.
We had a great time together. We really did. Big great. Fan.
So just on the same theme right here, what's the most surprising thing that you found as governor?
I think the most surprising thing is the depth and breadth of everything. You see it, right? But until you're kind of wearing that mantle, feeling the weight of it, I guess maybe that's what it is—not the depth and breadth, but more the weight of everything. We live in a time where most people are angry about something, and they all expect government to fix it. And I think that's a mistake, and I've said that openly, but you do feel that weight of every decision, of every heartache that's happening out there. You know, right now we have a shortage of baby formula. And it's something that is caused in large part because of government failures. Sadly, government failures at the federal level. And at the state level, there's very little that I can't snap my fingers and make more baby formula. We don't have any, you know, baby formula production facilities here in Utah. There isn't a lack of baby formula because of some Utah regulation that is out there. And yet, I and my team, we feel the weight of that responsibility. And so they're meeting together, trying to come up with data, ideas, anything we can do, figure out where the formula is in Utah and where we can get it to places where it isn't. Those are the, I think that's, that weight was a little surprising and very frustrating, because you run for office because you want to solve problems, and we have solved problems, and I'm excited to talk about some of those. But when there are problems you can't solve, it's crushing.
Yeah, I mean, remember that. So many phone calls that we received in the governor's office either before. The baby formula is a great example. And I even remember when I was a chief of staff, I was like, so when is the governor going to fix the cost of fuel? What might not surprise everyone in this room, but you don't control that, I guess.
I don't, but that's the expectation, yeah. Right? And so we're working on that too. How can we bring down the price of fuel? How can we influence the federal government and some of their policies to make it better? And I think that's frustrating to citizens, voters, and certainly to those of us that serve in these positions.
I would love to jump into the roadmap. So when you came into office, you created the One Utah Roadmap. I want to get to a couple of those items, because you put 6 points out, six key areas that you wanted to work on. And interestingly, you even had a version two. So if you're okay, I'd like to go through some of those things. Let's talk about version one.
Let's do it.
And then version two a little bit, because it did change a little bit in terms of the emphasis that you placed on a few things. So if you're okay, I'd love to go through a couple of those.
Absolutely.
So the first one was economic advancement, which you said this would include the ways the state can develop talent, incentivize businesses, and foster innovation. We're going through how we're doing on these. Talk about that one for just a moment, how we're doing, how we've done for the first 500 days, and where you see us going forward.
So this is the one that I'm most excited about because of the successes we've had. And look, we talk a lot about how great Utah is and how we have the best economy in the country. But some of the changes that we have made and put in place, and I want to give a shout out to my team. One thing about being governor is you don't do any of this alone. And I have the best team, I believe, in the history of the state. So many talented individuals, many of them are here tonight. I want to give a shout out to Dan Hemmert, former Senator Dan Hemmert, and his team. We have worked together with the legislature to really transform the way we do economic development in the state of Utah. We have a symbolic name change for the Governor's Office of Economic Development. It's now the Governor's Office of Economic Opportunity. And we did that because we wanted to be intentional about our focus. For so long, GOED had become kind of a Christmas tree, in that every time the legislature wanted to do something new or different and didn't know where to put it, they put it in GoEd. And our goal was to trim all of that back and get GoEd back to what it was supposed to be focusing on, and that is the economic opportunity for all Utahns, making sure that we're not just focused on those who are having the most success, but especially those at the margins, those who may be struggling. And so we've done that. Also, moving from a developing economy to a developed economy. Utah for so long has been a developing economy. It was very interesting. I went back and looked at some of the elections that happened in the 90s during the Levitt administration, and reading some of the debates and some of the speeches that were given, and they were very aspirational about what Utah could be and what we could become. And we got there. Being the number one economy over the past 10 years is really remarkable, and still maintaining that. Being the number one state for jobs created post-pandemic, well above every other state except Idaho. Idaho is very close to us. We're the two states that are far and away above everyone else. And yet our mindset has always had been that we've got to grow. We've got to reach the top. And so what do you do when you get to the top is the question. And so we really wanted to transform that mindset, and that's where incentives comes in. We've completely reorganized the way we do incentives here. Before it was, you threw an incentive at any job, any possible job. That makes sense when unemployment's at 5 or 6%, or when you're ranked 25th in the nation or 30th in the nation. Doesn't make sense when you're number one in the nation and unemployment is at 2%, lowest in our state's history, and we can't find jobs, and we're throwing incentives at businesses that are going to come anyway. And so we wanted to be much more strategic about that. What are we doing to help businesses that are already here? That makes much more sense to me. Let's make sure that if we are going to incentivize companies to come here, they're the right companies. We now get to be much more picky than we were 10, 20, 30 years ago. Now we get to decide what we want to be, because Utah is on the map in a way it hasn't been before. And we're the beneficiaries of those past governors and administrations and legislators, and most importantly, those business icons, the innovators that made Utah the state that it is today. And then really focusing on becoming the startup state, because that's where you get the most bang for your buck, when you have entrepreneurs that are creating businesses, keeping those businesses here and growing them here. We've certainly seen that in the tech sector. We're seeing it right now in the life sciences sector, which is incredible, and the growth that's happening there. We're seeing it in the finance sector, and that's what's going to make Utah special for decades to come.
As we talk about the great position the state of Utah has been for a period of time, most recently at our legislative session, records amounts of money to put towards things, but I think we better talk about the fact we have some significant headwinds, not just the state of Utah, but the country itself. You mentioned record low unemployment. We have inflation is going up dramatically. There are some significant financial impacts on our state coming forward. Talk about some of those, what you're looking forward to, is some of your ideas about how to approach that issue and mitigate it.
Sure. So when we look at those headwinds, and inflation right now, I would say, is the largest headwind that we have. And this is where it gets a little frustrating, because, you know, what can we do as a state? What tools do we have in our tool belt to kind of work on these things? And really help lift Utahns who are struggling the most. That's where my emphasis is. Look, most of us in this room are just fine. If we have to pay $4.50 for a gallon of gas, we don't like it, but we're gonna get through, and we're still gonna do the things we want to do. There are a lot of people out there that are making life-changing choices, right? Do I buy that gallon of gas? Do I buy this bag of groceries? Those are the choices facing people. And so we're working with the legislature to figure those things out. One of the ideas that I've really pushed, and I'm going to continue to push, is the idea of mass transit being free while we have this type of inflation. So we're giving people, and again, this doesn't help people in rural Utah, I understand that, but at least people that have access to mass transit now, would have an option, even if it takes a little longer. Maybe it, you know, it takes me 45 minutes to get to work instead of 25 minutes to get to work, but I can do it, and I can save that money instead of spending $5 for a gallon of gas. Now I can use that for other things. And so really focusing on them, looking at our food banks and what's happening. We know that our food banks are under stress, so let's work to make sure that, again, the people that need it the most are getting it the most. And that's where our focus is turning right now. But then this is the most important part of all of this. And that is when we talk about investing in the future, and infrastructure, and one of the things I'm proud of is we've invested in infrastructure, more infrastructure dollars over the past 2 years than any time in our state's history. But investing in people as infrastructure, we have these jobs available. 2% unemployment is a huge opportunity for people to upskill their job, to get a higher paying job, to lift people. It's not just enough to give them free transit or give people free groceries. Let's give them free opportunity or better opportunity to improve their lives so that they don't have to choose between gas and food. And we have those options available now. Higher ed is a partner with us in making that happen. The changes that we've made to our trade and technical institutions to give people these opportunities. There has never been a better time in the state of Utah to get a better job than there is right now.
Let's talk about that for just a moment too, because I'll put this in the headwinds category, but something to deal with as well is as we start having economic activity in the state and prices go up for certain things, we do have issues associated with affordable housing. You mentioned transportation. These are big issues we still have to account for as a state. And what's interesting when you look at the economic development efforts, there are people in the state of Utah say, you know, how fast do we want to grow? You know, how do we control that in such a way that we are taking into account the resources we have as a state as well? And I know that you're hearing a lot about that from people as well. Your response to that with what we're doing through the Governor's Office of Economic Opportunity or other places?
Sure. So we I have to give a shout out to the legislature as well. We have an incredible partnership right now. One of the things that we've accomplished together is this. We have a committee that works together on all of the big issues, and it's the executive branch and the legislative branch coming together on this Unified Economic Opportunity Commission, and the whole idea behind that was really to kind of hack the legislative process, and in that the executive branch together with leadership, so the speaker and the president and other people, key leaders throughout the state, higher ed is represented there, we have mayors that are represented there as well, that we come together and start focusing on these big issues and with real specific proposals. And then we take those proposals and we put them into the form of legislation, and we run them through the committee process so that they are ready to go and they're the first bills that are passed during the legislative session. This last year was the first time we attempted this model, and it worked brilliantly. So I share that because this is the wonky stuff that nobody pays attention to, but that really matters. It allows us an opportunity to change the course of history for the state. So we ran some, we decided a little later in the process that housing was going to be an important piece of this. And so we threw it into the process. Now, it was a little late. We were able to get a couple bills out of there. Representative Waldrop ran those bills. There were some changes that were made to those. Now, those are just coming into effect right now. But the whole idea there was that we had to increase supply of housing in the state of Utah. Very simple supply and demand issue. And if demand is high, prices are rising, so we have to increase the supply. So we're working with the League of Cities and Towns and others to look at zoning, making sure that around transit areas, transit hubs, that we have the ability to increase density, because that's the only way we're going to get on the other side of this. And density is not a bad thing. I mean, it can be a bad thing if you don't have the infrastructure, but we have the infrastructure in certain places, and we should be focusing on density in those areas. And so we were able to get that bill through, and we're going to go through that process. We're meeting again in a few days to start that process again for the next year. And so all of these issues, housing, water. We went through significant changes in water conservation. We changed about a dozen laws, implemented a dozen new laws around water conservation. That all went through the same process, the executive branch, the legislative branch, working hand in hand, getting that through very, very quickly in an organized manner, and it will make a significant difference. So that's how we're attacking these headwinds. We could go it on our own, but if you don't bring the legislature along, it's never going to happen.
I want to get to a couple of those issues dealing with water in particular, because you have something dealing with rural Utah as well. But before I leave economic development, I just want to make a note that you just got back from a trade mission to Mexico. I saw the social media. You got a chance to use your Spanish as well. Talk about that trade mission and the role of Utah businesses on the international stage, which is so interesting right now because some of that has been disrupted so much around the world.
Yeah, it's really phenomenal, and I could spend the whole evening just talking about our time in Mexico. We went to Mexico City, which is the political capital of Mexico, and then we went to Guadalajara, Jalisco, the state of Jalisco, which is the cultural capital of Mexico, and it was so impressive to see Utah businesses interacting with our friends in Mexico. We took a couple dozen businesses that were down there with us. And the fascinating thing is usually we go on these trade missions, and the idea is to convince the country that we're going to and businesses there to really invest in Utah. This was very different. It was really the opposite. Every business that went with us and dozens more, probably thousands more, as we've talked across the state, are looking to do more business in Mexico. And specifically, because of what's happening from a geopolitical sense, they want to get out of China. And there's a couple reasons for that. One, nearshoring or reshoring is good because people want their stuff and they want it very quickly, right? So you want to push a button and you want Amazon to deliver it tomorrow, or today, I guess, in Salt Lake now, we get it today. So that's hard to do when the stuff you're making is overseas, right? And so that's the first reason. The second reason, of course, supply chains are being disrupted. And that's been very difficult for manufacturers here in the United States, manufacturers here in Utah. They know it would be much easier if they can manufacture in Mexico or here in Utah. And then third, the way the government in China has been treating U.S. businesses, the hostility that exists there, businesses just aren't feeling comfortable doing business there anymore. And so by meeting with our counterparts in Mexico, we were able to make connections there that will help us for years to come as more and more Utah companies look to bring manufacturing both here and in Mexico, expand, which is good for both of our economies. And by the way, will help us solve all of the issues that we're seeing at the border right now. If Mexico's economy is strong, we will see much less fewer border problems as people are trying to come from Mexico into the United States. So there really is a win-win here for both of our countries. And we have to start thinking that way. A stronger North America positions us very well to compete with Europe and Asia. And so we have something to invest in Mexico. And they were so excited to have us there. We were the first trade mission to come back to Mexico since the pandemic. We beat Colorado by 2 days, and we were very excited to be there on the ground.
I was always amazed at just how much Utah plays on the international stage. For a place that's not by any body of water, we certainly do have a big impact around the world. I want to get to a couple other points from your roadmap, if that's okay. The next one was education, innovation, and investment, including how the state can recruit and retain quality teachers and focus on at-risk learners. I think this is such a critical component, and nothing has highlighted the need more than what's happened over the last 2 years. Progress on that big, overwhelming issue.
Yeah, it is a big one, and it's an incomplete. We're certainly not there. We've done a tremendous amount of work. I shout out to Brittany, who's doing amazing work with us. She's not here with us tonight, but working on, she's my education advisor. And also the First Lady, who has taken on this issue, Abby, who is a special educator and feels very passionate, especially about the teacher side of this. So there are two pieces that you mentioned there. One, doing more for at-risk students. Very proud of legislation that we were able to help push through to give more funding for at-risk students. We're creating a WPU, a weighted pupil unit, which is the funding metric for our students, and doing that for at-risk students. So getting more money for at-risk students. This will help our schools that are struggling, our Title I schools. It will help rural schools get more funding where it's needed. So grateful for the leadership of Superintendent Dixon, who is here with us tonight. Everything that she and her team are doing to really reach out to these most vulnerable kids, and certainly this pandemic has we've seen the data. We're very fortunate here in the state of Utah that we were one of the first states to open our schools up, to keep our schools open. We recognized very early on how important in-person learning actually was. You know this, your kids were not able to come back in one certain school district for a long time, and we had to fight hard to get that open. But we know how important that was. And those kids, especially at the margins, who struggled when they weren't in person, getting more attention, more dollars to help them progress is going to be critical over the next few years. And then the teacher portion. I'm very worried about our teachers. I've talked about this often. Being a teacher was hard before the pandemic. It's become almost impossible since the pandemic with all the political polarization that's happening out there and the attacks on our teachers. I'm very concerned about the welfare of our teachers. And when you have 2% unemployment, there are lots of opportunities for teachers to do other things and make more money. So our focus has been on increasing teacher compensation and making sure that we are working to create an atmosphere, a culture where teachers are appreciated, where they feel loved and respected. And that's what one of the First Ladies Initiative is working on, just the mental health of our teachers, making sure that they're taking care of themselves. You can't lift a group of students if you're struggling yourself. And so she's got a conference coming up this summer that we're very excited about that will help teachers in that area as well.
One more thing on this, which is so interesting, because you talked about dollars to education. I'm just kind of curious, and Sid Dixon does such a good job on the policy and advising as well. When you look at the kind of the improvement in these areas, what do you look at success being like here? Because you always hear, I'll just say, we always hear all the time, it's the WPU, you know, what percentage is that we're putting in? Is the state of Utah, where are we on that list? But it seems like that's not really the right measure necessarily of how we're measuring success in the state. How do you look at that?
Sure. So, well, when we're measuring, you know, how we're compensating our teachers, I look at that first, even before the WPU. And I want to thank the legislature. We've been able to get record amount of compensation, record amount of funding for K-12 education over the last couple of years. And that's something that we should all be very proud of. But I'm looking at, is that getting to the end of the row? Is that getting to the teachers? I believe for a long time that, look, if you give me, if we're gonna have a little competition here, and we're gonna train up two kids, and you let me choose the teacher, and I let you choose everything else. You can choose the curriculum, you can choose the computers, you can choose the school and the classroom. I'll give you every other choice, but I get to choose the teacher. I'm going to win every time. Because I think it's that important. I think it is the single most important input into a child's education is the teacher, and there isn't a close second. And so that's really where I want to be investing. And then, of course, our school districts do a great job of this, measuring the effectiveness of those teachers. And then training, taking our best teachers and helping them train other teachers, making sure that the legislature, with our encouragement, is investing in teacher training again, something we haven't done for a while. So significant dollars were put aside this session to help invest in training teachers. Because if you can take a good teacher and put them in a bad situation, and that's not good for anyone. But we've seen over and over again, there are schools that outperform their zip codes. Schools where you would expect kids to not perform very well, but they're performing exceptionally well. When you look at that school, what do they have? They have an incredible principal, and they have amazing teachers. Teachers that work together, collaborate together, help each other out. Recreating that and making sure that it's available, you can take a mediocre teacher and make them really, really good. You can also take a great teacher and ruin them if they're in the wrong situation. So making sure that we have that culture and that atmosphere for all of our teachers.
Let's go to rural. You called it your plan called it Rural Matters. You did a couple of very interesting things, particularly when it comes to moving jobs into rural Utah. Talk about that for just a minute. How successful that has been. And I even know throughout state government, if there's a job that could be just as well done in rural Utah, you have to try to identify that. Talk about how that has worked and how it's helped those parts of the state.
Yeah, so we've had a couple initiatives here. One is just to move state government jobs into rural Utah. When you have 2% unemployment, we're an employer along the Wasatch Front. We're struggling to hire people as well because there are more jobs than people available right now. So if we can move those jobs to rural Utah where unemployment is higher, we still have counties with 4% unemployment, 5% unemployment, we can move these jobs there, that's a huge benefit to that community, a huge benefit to a family, keeps a family in a school there, helps that, you know, that person can now run for office in the city, they can join the PTA, they can do all of those things. So we've moved, I don't remember the last number, 130, something like that, Chief. Close to 200 now. See, there we go. We're close to 200 jobs that we've been able to move out into rural Utah. It doesn't seem like a huge number, but again, one job on the Wasatch Front one job in rural Utah is worth 1,000 jobs on the Wasatch Front sometimes. I mean, it matters in these really small counties. So that's been really important for us. We've also been encouraging other businesses to look to rural Utah as they're looking to expand, especially in manufacturing and in other areas. We were piloting before the pandemic. We had a very big project to have people work from home and to move those jobs to rural Utah so people could work from anywhere. And when the pandemic hit, we were ready. And now the rest of the world has figured out that, yeah, you don't have to live in downtown Salt Lake City to work for a firm in downtown Salt Lake City. And so more and more companies are finding out that they can hire these incredible workers. I know we have Steve Neeleman's here with us tonight, and his company has been able to expand and in price in Carbon County. They've been able to move some of their supervisory positions down there recently, and that's the type of excitement that we're seeing, as now you can have the same opportunity in rural Utah that you would have along the Wasatch Front. That's going to do so many things. It will allow kids like me who grew up in rural Utah to stay there. It will allow kids who had to move away because there wasn't a job now the opportunity to move back home and raise their families there, and everyone benefits.
One more thing, this is the whole state, not just rural Utah, but you mentioned it a moment ago. I want to make sure we talk about water for just a minute. We are facing a significant drought in Utah, here in the West, severe implications, maybe for people who are watching here, but who will be watching after this and live here today as well. What is the direction? From the top, what's the direction as we get into the summer months?
Yeah, so the direction is very clear, and that is that we need people to conserve again this year like they did last year. If we do what we did last year again, we'll be just fine. So the good news is we know we can do it. We surprised ourselves last year, to be honest, at the billions of gallons of water that we were able to save by people making very smart decisions. And I'm really proud of the people of Utah and the way that they stepped up. And unfortunately, we need to do that again. We are still in a historic drought. Our reservoirs are only about 60% full. That's not great news. That's down from this time last year. And so we're working from a deficit. We're starting from a deficit. And so from the very beginning, we've got to peel back on watering our lawns, just be smarter about it, water less. It's okay if we have yellow, brown patches this year. We're going to get through. That's a big difference. Our farmers are going to make huge sacrifices again this year. The good news is, again, the legislature, we set aside almost $500 million in water conservation money this year. A significant piece of that will go to farmers to allow them to upgrade their technology, which will allow them with less water to improve their yields. So that's a win-win for everybody. And I'm very confident we're going to be able to get through this year.
Okay, I'd like to get to the next principle here. This is health security. You almost have to just talk about COVID for a moment on this, but we could take all night. So I'm not. But my really big question for you, really, on this particular right here. Your one or two top lessons learned. You became governor at a time when we're in the throes of this pandemic. All right, it was a pretty rough time to start this particular. So just one or two key number one lessons that you learned from that experience that would impact us today.
Yeah, so we we have to learn from this experience. And the good news for everyone is that that there are lessons that will help us in all kinds of ways moving forward. The two at the top, I would say, are this. Collaboration really matters. And what we found we were able to do, our hospital systems were able to start working together in ways they had never done before. Our public health was able to work with our business community, with the private sector, the nonprofit sector, even the faith-based sector, all working together for the common good. So we've taken those lessons and we've created this Utah Health Collaborative. The idea is that we're going to work together to lower the cost of healthcare, improve outcomes, and reach out to those who have struggled. And this is the second point I want to get to that we learned. And that is, we knew this on paper, but there is a disparity in the delivery of healthcare and the health outcomes of people that live in this state, often based on zip code, sometimes based on your race, the community in which you live. COVID made that very real as we started to see, first with our Latino community, when we saw some of the first outbreaks were much higher there, hospitalizations were higher. We certainly saw it in our Native American community, where the death rates were significantly higher, and so we're working with those communities. We figured some things out to how to deliver, how to move healthcare closer to the people. The University of Utah has an incredible project on the west side of the Salt Lake Valley that I believe is a direct result of some of the lessons that we learned coming out of COVID, moving hospital access out there, moving jobs out there, again, getting healthcare delivery closer to the people that need it the most, breaking down language barriers. We passed several laws, changed several laws here in the state of Utah that allowed us to reach people in their language, to meet people where they are. And so those two things, I think, are the most important lessons that will prove valuable for a long time to come.
The next one is equality and opportunity. So I'm just going to give you the first one and version two. I'll just give you both of those together. It was including leading by example to improve racial and gender disparities in state government. And version two added access to boards and commissions for underrepresented groups. I particularly like to talk about a couple of things like gender pay equity, for example, which is something you've talked about. It's a critical thing we must address in the state.
Yeah, so one of the very first things I did as governor, and I want to thank my lieutenant governor, who's not here with us tonight. She's actually on a trade mission. I'm very fortunate to have the best lieutenant governor in the country. We worked together to do a pay study in every division of state government, and to find out where those disparities existed. Did we have gender disparities in pay? The good news is we found that we had very minor disparities, but in some areas, in some divisions, in some departments, they were higher. And so we had to go in and fix those. And we did that. And we believe that sets an example for the rest of the state. And we're constantly talking to the private sector about doing the same thing, sharing our experience and how they can learn from that. We also have had Dr. Susan Madsen come and meet with us. I would say, at least here in Utah, probably the foremost expert when it comes to gender disparities in our state. I'm not proud that that Wallet Hub has done a study that found that Utah was the worst state in the nation when it comes to some of those disparities. So we had her actually come in. We had her come in and talk to our team about that study. We went through every variable in that study, and we're working on ways to improve in those areas, working with the legislature as well. What can we do as government to help improve and make sure that there is opportunity, again, for everyone, that there aren't economic disparities, and that Utah is a place where everyone feels welcome. And so that's been a huge focus of our administration. That's one of the reasons for the change there in 2.0. We have hundreds of boards and commissions here in the state. Way too many, by the way. I'm always trying to get the legislature to work on that. We've got close to 400 boards and commissions. And we're begging people to apply for these boards and commissions. And far too often, it's the same people that we get on there. So we're really making an outreach effort, looking to new communities, asking for names, volunteers, people who are willing to serve, to give them these opportunities. And that's where you notice people. That's where you find people. And those positions often lead to other higher positions, people get encouraged to run for office who maybe wouldn't have thought of it before. They get to interact with people in high-ranking offices that they wouldn't get otherwise. And so we're really proud of the work that's happening there.
Just one more thing in this category, particularly considering your approach, the LGBTQ plus community, where does it fall within this particular pillar?
Yeah, well, it falls right there as well. And working hard to make sure that we have laws that are fair, and again, that everyone feels welcome. So this has become, I guess it's always been a very controversial issue. And we've made some real progress here, some progress that we're proud of. Several years ago, of course, Utah received national attention, international attention, for passing a law that protected the LGBTQ plus community in housing and employment, while also preserving preserving religious freedoms in our state. And we're proud of that, and we think that's the model going forward. Now, it hasn't always worked out that way. Of course, we had a very contentious issue this session that led to a veto and a veto override. So we're going to continue to push on these issues to find ways for us to come together. I truly believe we have much more in common than we have the things that divide us. And making sure that community feels welcome here in the state of Utah is something that I'm very passionate about.
Very good. Governor, I have a bunch more, but I know we have some audience questions. You ready to take some of those?
I'm absolutely ready.
Jennifer, do we have, look at that, on cue. A stack, are you serious?
You ready for this?
Yeah. You ready for this, Governor?
And while we're getting those, I should probably apologize. First of all, it's almost impossible to talk through these things. And so it's cutting off the oxygen to my brain. Also, COVID brain is a real thing. So I have no idea what I've been saying. And if it doesn't make any sense, please forgive me for the
COVID far, brain. Remarkably so. All right, it seems, good. But it is hard to talk through these, particularly up here and the lights are on. You ready for a couple of these?
Yes.
All right. And I should have brought my glasses. You can see my age already. My neighborhood is slowly filling in with luxury apartments. This is forcing many people to move due to rising prices. What can be done to promote affordable housing?
Yeah, so fortunately, this is a glass half full answer. We worked really hard with the legislature this year. We got about half the money we were hoping for. But that half the money, over $50 million, is more than we've ever gotten before when it comes to affordable housing. And so we're working with mayors as well on the affordable housing issue. We have an incredible public servant who has joined our team, Wayne Niederhauser, former president of the Senate, who is working on homelessness issues and affordable housing issues. And so I am also very optimistic there. Back to a previous question you asked, we can't stop the growth from happening. We can't build a wall around Utah and decide who gets to come in and who doesn't get to come in. I don't think that's the right answer either. But what we can do is we can make sure that people are moving here and people that have lived here forever understand the values that have made Utah so special. And this is one of those values, that we lead the nation in upward mobility. But that's not a given. That doesn't happen by accident. It only happens if we're intentional about it. So making sure that we have housing available, low-income housing everywhere in the state of Utah, is really important. And this means this is where some of this tension comes in. And we just saw this in Summit County, where sometimes the incentive structure is such that local authorities have no incentive to allow that type of housing in their jurisdiction. In fact, it's just the opposite. Even I've had mayors and city council members come and tell me, we know we need to approve this project, but if we do, we'll all lose our jobs, and there'll be a referendum and it'll get overturned anyway. And so this is where the state is going to have to, and is having a conversation. And I'm a local control guy. I'm a former mayor and a former city councilman, former county commissioner. Having a conversation about the NIMBYism and where is that line and where is the decision, where should the decision be made and the best decisions be made. And I think we're getting there, again, back to this area where if there is a state nexus and a state investment, if we've put a transit hub or we've built a freeway and an exchange, then you have to allow more density and affordable housing in some of those areas. And in so doing, I think we can find that right balance so that everyone, our children and grandchildren, will have a place to live for decades to come.
Very good. Governor, how do you How do you plan to strengthen the state's relationship with the tribes in the state?
Well, one of the best decisions I've made is to have the lieutenant governor specifically assigned to work with our tribal entities, and she has done an amazing job. As she has traveled the state, she's worked with all 8 of our federally recognized tribes, and we've seen significant improvements in that relationship. The work that she has done down in southern Utah around Westwater, in getting utilities to a place that has not had utilities before, we're talking electricity, running water, those types of basics, has been incredibly well received. We were able to finally get the Navajo Water Act passed through Congress, through the great work of Senator Hatch, who has left us. Senator Romney picked that up and helped us get that across the finish line. That's a really big deal. We've had much better discussions with the Ute tribe over the last several months. And so it really is a strategic focus, traveling around, meeting them again where they are, not always coming to Salt Lake City, but us going there and being with them. And Lieutenant Governor Henderson has been masterful in her relationships with the tribe.
Very good. This next question, I'm gonna do a little preface to this next question because I think it's very timely as well. It's a new CNN, my stats are gonna lead into this question. A new CNN poll just came out today, said that 53% of Americans describe themselves as being burned out on politics. Hard to believe, right? Burned out on politics. 32% feel like their side is losing, and 23% are, this is quote, fired up. So here's the question from the audience. What can we as Utahns do to decrease divisiveness and increase civility? Absolutely needed.
Yeah, and this has been a real focus of our administration. Look, I like to refer to those, I think you said 53%, as the exhausted majority.
Exhausted majority, yes.
Yeah, the exhausted majority. And I'm surprised it's only 53%. It's incumbent on all of us. We can't expect it to come from Washington, D.C. I believe our politicians are a reflection of us, of we the people, and we have to start demanding it of them. And that's hard when you're exhausted. But the way we do that is we do it individually, and then we teach those correct principles to our children. We share them with our friends. To me, it's really about getting proximate to people. It's important to listen to people who are different than us. If you're a Republican, you should have some friends who are Democrats, and you should listen to them. Not listen to debate, but listen to understand. And what you'll find, at least what I find, is that even when we disagree, our hearts are usually in the same place or the right place. And that gives us an opportunity to work on some common ideals and then find a pathway to get there. I believe that is happening here in Utah. I believe we're better at it than most places. But again, this session you saw that's not always the case. And so I hope and I believe that Utah can be that example. I don't have the perfect answer, except to say that I share that concern. I talk about it all the time. I hope I'm setting a good example of that. I fail sometimes, but it's not for a lack of trying. I'm constantly trying to reach out to people who disagree with me, to listen to them, to try to understand, and then see if we can't find a pathway forward. I also try to never use fear and divisiveness as a tool to gain votes or to win. I think it's not only what we do but how we do it that matters. And so I hope that we can model the how to do it right part. Again, I'm not perfect. I fail at it over and over again, but I keep trying. So you will see me disagree and disagree passionately with the president on some of their policies. I think some of the policies that they've implemented make absolutely no sense. They've made the economy worse. They've made inflation worse, and they're hurting people. But I also don't take. I try never to take low blows. you know, name calling, pot shots at the president. I respect him as I respected the president before. And I think we have an opportunity to work together to solve the biggest issues. And we can never work together if we're just constantly attacking each other. So I'll point out the differences, I'll point out where I think they're wrong, and then I'll try to find ways to work together to fix those.
The modeling of these kinds of dialogues is just so critical, and not a ton of examples, so it's good when we find them. The next question, you touched on this a little bit, but let's go a little deeper into this. What would you say to people who fear that Utah will look unrecognizable come 15 to 20 years? The examples they gave: climate, culture, economy.
Well, what I would say to that is that those are choices, and those are choices that we all get to make, and those are choices that we are making. We've seen the legislature step up when it comes to the Great Salt Lake in ways I honestly didn't expect. I had fairly low expectations, but we were able to get them out there to see the lake, to see what was happening. And then what happened was they galvanized. They galvanized around funding. They galvanized around some very significant policy changes that I thought would take us 4 or 5 years to get done, and that we were able to get done all in 1 year. And there's still more to come. But that says to me that we can that we can adapt, that we can respond to what's happening out there, and we can make the changes that are necessary. Well, when it comes to growth, Utah is going to continue to grow, and some people think that's a terrible thing. I'm not one of those people. Again, most of our growth is internal, and now I will admit that for the first time, external growth did outpace internal growth over the past year, and yet there was another data point that came out that just fascinated me, and I wish I had it all in front of me. Maybe it came out of the University of Utah, but it was that people moving into a state, so this is external growth, people moving back in Utah, 25% of that growth were people who had lived here before. These are people coming home. Now, the thing that's remarkable about that, we were number one, and number two was way, way below that. I mean, most states were less than 1% of those moving back were people moving home, and we were 25%. I wish I had all the data, but it was remarkable. So not just number one, but number one by leaps and bounds, and that says something about how special this place is. I want Utah to be a place where people want to come back, people who grew up here. And I think we should be proud of that. So it may be unrecognizable in that the skyline is changing, in that more and more people are living here, but it will always, I hope and pray, will be recognizable as a place where people feel welcome, where they feel a sense of community, and those are choices we get to make.
The next question from the audience is kind of close to my heart too, being here at the University of Utah, where we try to get our students to be politically engaged and to stay in the process. This question is this: what advice would you give to the youth of Utah?
Well, the advice I would give them is to stop being so cynical. I'm really worried about a generation who sees only the worst in the world. Despite all of the challenges and troubles we've talked about, we live in one of the greatest eras in the history of the world. We live in the greatest state, in the greatest country, in the history of the world. I truly believe that. And so, yes, there are bad things out there, but there have always been bad things out there. Look for the good. Look for the good that exists out there, and you'll find it in ample form. There are more job opportunities than ever before, again, with unemployment so low. Technology is changing our world. Our ability to communicate is better than ever before. The extreme poverty across the world is at its lowest point ever. Despite the battles that are happening in Ukraine, we live at a time when there is less war, less famine than ever before in the history of the world. All of these things are very positive. There is so much to look forward to, especially here in Utah. And so my advice to them would be, again, stop being so cynical. Look for the good that's out there, and then look for ways to improve the world around you, and those exist too. Instead of being upset or angry at politicians or policies, Get involved. You know, work with a candidate. Go volunteer on a campaign somewhere. Learn how this system works, and then run yourself.
Yeah. So interesting. You know, we get our political identity so early in our lives, and the generations coming up right now is facing a lot of significant hurdles right now that are impacting their political views and their participation as well. So I think it's a really important point there.
Yeah, I would also tell them to turn off politics a little more often. I don't get your political identity so early. You know, talk to lots of people, listen and learn, and you'll find that again, most people aren't as evil as you think they are, and it's okay to not completely form all of your political identity by the time you're 12.
Do you mind if I just follow up on that thread a little bit?
No.
'Cause I thought it was interesting. You put out a tweet with an article from The Atlantic,
yeah,
which I, of course, read. I'm sure many in the room did. In fact, I made sure I noted it. Jonathan Haidt, which is interesting when it gets to the youth. I hope you don't mind just a little detour from this a little bit. This article is interesting. One of the points that you brought about, too, is particularly for our youth, and some of our generation right now have not had a single day without a smart device in their hand. And one of the things in this article that you seem to mention a little bit, too, is how the sort of the like button, the retweet button, these are some of the issues that are really impacting not just the political identity, but the participation of our youth and people throughout the country, and how we have to maybe guard against that.
Yeah, it's something we're worried about. One of the things that we're working on our roadmap is mental health and mental health services available. Unfortunately, what we're seeing is just this huge increase in poor mental health outcomes for our youth. And if you look back, they track almost completely with the adoption of social media and smart devices, right? And so while, you know, causation maybe hasn't been completely proven, the correlation is certainly there, and certainly to a point that it should give all of us pause in the way that our kids are interacting with the world, and the way social media is hurting or impeding their mental health and their growth, I share deep concern. I think that was a very interesting article. That Jonathan Haidt is a wonderful writer and researcher and thought leader in this area, but also how those same tools are undermining our democratic republic and our belief in each other. And so it starts at a very young age, unfortunately, and I'm not sure the brain is developed to such a point that it can handle some of the some of the incentives that are being induced and some of the problems that come out of that.
Just one thing on this. How do you find that balance? I mean, you're pretty active on social media. What is that balance that you find? Because, you know, sometimes, I mean, we talk about cable news, how yep. sometimes it can be polarizing, but sometimes you have to go on cable news. You know, they have to interview and talk about the issues as well. What's your balance there when you're engaging with social media and therefore the people in the state?
Yeah, it's something I struggle with too. I will have to say I've had to use the mute button a lot more since I became governor. And that is for my own mental health. You know, you can only see so much criticism of yourself before it starts to be debilitating, and certainly the criticism is important and being open and transparent. But that's important. Really, trying to find that balance. And sometimes I get out of whack with that as well. Sometimes I find I'm spending too much time on social media, and I have to back away a little bit. Cable news thing, same thing. We used to watch cable news in our house every day. We haven't watched it for 9 years. One of the best decisions we made, and we've certainly seen that in the lives of some of our loved ones, as people's personalities have actually changed, as they've gotten addicted to the outrage of cable news or the outrage of social media. So social media, to me, is a tool. It's a little different than cable news because cable news only comes one way, right? Social media, we're all content creators as well, so we're participating in the conversation. And so I have to ask myself, am I adding in a positive way to that conversation, or am I adding to the division and the deterioration that exists out there? And this is another place where I don't always get it right. I think more often than not, I'm adding to the conversation in a positive way, but every once in a while, it's really easy to attack and take some pot shots.
Such an interesting balancing act there. This next one is interesting because it goes back to your time as a lieutenant governor. Is there anything you wanted to do as lieutenant governor but didn't get a chance to that you've now been able to do in your first 500 days as governor?
Oh, wow.
Wow.
That's a very interesting. Yeah. One of the things I always wanted to do as lieutenant governor that I never got a chance to do that I have now as governor is to veto bills. There were lots of bills I wanted to veto as lieutenant governor and never got that opportunity.
Okay, do we have time for one more, Jen? Okay, this will be the last one.
Last
it just happens to be one in my hand, you know, so I'm just came as they come. In this climate of division nationally and in our state, how do you ensure that we stay focused on Utah values and policies that ensure Utahns have opportunity to not get sucked into so many distracting and divisive issues? Sorry, this is going to have to be the last one, but it's pretty good.
Yeah, it's a great question, a good one to end on. This is the whole thing. I mean, that's it. I would love to hear all of your advice on how we can do this better. I think to me, it's, if I might just be a little candid, it's probably the most frustrating part of being governor is that I have this amazing team, and I just want to thank my team again. You were a chief of staff. Jason, you know how important that job is. I have the best chief of staff in the world. And I'm so grateful for his leadership and every one of my team members as I look out across the audience tonight. And these team members are doing incredible things, big things, things I never dreamed we'd be able to do in the first 500 days. And there's so much of it that we can't even share it all. It's shocking the accomplishments that they've been able to make. And yet, all anyone wants to talk about is some dumb thing a teacher did in Virginia, or you know, something a cop did in California, or I used to, and I've said this many times, but we in political science 101, we learned that all politics is local, that used to be true. I don't think it's true anymore. I think all politics is national, and it's very frustrating when there's a local school board race. And all they want to talk about is national issues, often things that they have no control over whatsoever. And so I don't know the answer to this except to say that I and my administration are committed to focusing on the issues that really matter and the stuff that government is supposed to be doing. And I believe we do it better here than anywhere else because we have so many amazing public servants, dedicated people, every one of whom could be making much more money or doing other things that would be incredibly rewarding for them, and that on paper doesn't make sense that they would be doing these jobs, but they're doing them anyway. And I'm so proud of that, and I'm so proud to be a part of that. And I hope that the people of Utah will recognize that, and that we'll understand that sometimes, many times, the things we're fighting about, the things that the cable news is screaming, the things that social media is telling us that we have to choose between, that we have to tear people down about, really don't matter in the long run. It's the thousands of other things that do matter that are making people's lives much better. And those are the things that our administration is really trying to focus on. And we hope we get to do that for the next 500 days.
Yeah, absolutely. It's so important to take time to reflect on where we have come from, how far we've come, and where we need to go. And it's just always a critical part of public service, I think, to do that. So I appreciate you taking some time with us tonight to go through these points and what we have coming for the future. Thank you to all. Those were great questions that you all asked. Let's give a hand, Governor Spencer Cox.
Thanks, everyone. Thank you.